Thank you very much for all making your way here this morning to share in our 43 Lancaster Gate Family Church Sunday service. We're going to have, I'm sure, an amazing experience together with our God and true parents today and with each other. So I'd just like to start off by welcoming you and welcoming our Heavenly Father and true parents to join us this morning. So we meet every week here in Lancaster Gate to share together God's love with one another. And we can do this in many ways. We can do this through receiving a sermon from our pastor, which we will get later on in our program. The topic of today's sermon is Arms Strong Enough to Carry Us. That's the title of the sermon. And we can also do this through singing praises and worshipping our Heavenly Father and true parents. So the music ministry will lead us later on. We can also do it through prayers and meditation, so we'll have time for that as well. And also by just sharing love with one another. So that's how we're going to start off. So let's begin by rising and greeting one another. Maybe say hi to somebody that perhaps you've never met before, find out who they are, shake their hand, and share some love.
Make sure the order's right. Oh my goodness me.
Sorry, thanks.
Is he all right? Oh my gosh.
Okay, so good morning.
Good morning.
There's a lot of chatting going on, a lot of relating, getting to know each other, hopefully. A lot of fresh faces. I'm sure many of you experienced the fresh morning wind today. It's so nice to be inside and be warm and cozy. So we're going to build on that cozy feeling all together, and we're going to sing some songs to raise the spirit. So we begin with Shining Fatherland and Hills and Valleys. So if you'll please join us and rise and sing together. loud and clear, and a wonderful chorus of young voices at the front. Beautiful. Okay. So I want to hear the same volume with a quieter, slow tempo song, Be Thou My Vision.
So please join me in reciting our family pledge number 3. Our family, the owner of Chanorguk, pledges to perfect the 4 great realms of heart, the 3 great kingships, and the realm of the royal family by centering on true love. Please be seated and join me in prayer. Our dearest, most beloved Heavenly Father, our true parents, we're so grateful that we could all be here this morning to share this beautiful day with you, Heavenly Father. We're so grateful for the many things that you do for us in our life. We're thankful for our health and for the works that we're able to go out and do, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, as we gather here, we really want to ask your presence here with us, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, this is a very special time for you. We're leading up to our Foundation Day in just a few weeks, Heavenly Father. And we really want to be able to really look at the bigger picture, but see the part that we need to play, our individual responsibility, and really take that seriously and really invest ourselves 100% in doing your will, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, I'd like to offer this time to you on behalf of all my brothers and sisters here, and in my own name, Veronica Mould, daughter of Adjo and Nitya Mould, which is a blessed central family, Archu. Okay, so we've got quite a few announcements today, so I'm going to ask the Sunday School to head down to their class, so please give a warm round of applause for these amazing children. Okay, so the announcement. So to start off, our 2013 church calendars are now available. So if you'd like one, please contact Mr. Hayashi. And then today we have the annual general meeting for our Lancaster Gate community. It starts at 2 p.m. and we'll be here in the ballroom. So please, if you can, please do attend so that we can really help to mould our vision for the year and reflect on the year that's gone past. On Wednesday the 16th, so that's this Wednesday, and on the 23rd, we have a Q&A regarding the Foundation Day. So it will be in the cafe on Wednesday, and if you'd like to attend, please contact our pastor, Simon Cooper, to register. And then on Saturday the 19th, we have a Foundation Day workshop. It's £10 and lunch is provided. There are 10 people registered so far, and especially if you're thinking about attending Foundation Day, it's really important that you should attend a workshop so you're up to speed with everything that's happening. So yes, please contact Mr. Hayashi if you'd like to register for the Foundation Day workshop on the 19th. There are also two alternative Foundation Day workshops. There's one in Birmingham from the 19th to 20th of January, and one in Cleve House on the 26th to 27th of January. Then on, let's see, where am I? Okay, so on the 20th, there will be a Tribal Messiah meeting with Martin Maloney at 1:15. So that's next week Sunday at 1:15 with Martin Maloney. And, okay, two more. So this is becoming a regular event. So on Thursdays, we have witnessing here at 43 Lancaster Gate. We start at 11 o'clock and it's till 1 o'clock. So just for 2 hours of focused witnessing. So we'll meet here and then prepare for about 15 minutes and then go out and then finish at 1 o'clock and meet back here. So it's very short and focused, and hopefully that will bring great results. I believe 4 people were here last week and they really enjoyed it and were very happy. So it's definitely something to consider. So that's Thursday at 11 o'clock. And finally, I don't know if you remember that Waits were doing a raffle, and there's the first prize is a car. The raffle is soon coming to a close, so today is the last day if you want to be in it to win it, to get your tickets. So please contact either George or Uncle Marshall for that. Okay. So as I said earlier, today the sermon's topic is, or title is, Armstrong Enough to Carry Us. But before we invite up our pastor, Simon Cooper, to give this message, we'd like to invite up the music ministry to lead us in a few more songs. Oh, wait, sorry. Before all of that, I'd like to invite up our pastor, Simon. As is tradition, when we welcome new people into our community who have expressed a wish to become a member or part of our community, we like to do a little ceremony to welcome them in. So I'd like to invite up our Simon Pastor Cooper to do that.
Thank you, Lorraine. So actually the people I'm introducing today, actually they've been here for a while, and of course when I discussed it with them, they pointed that out. But actually I said I still like it since you're here. We can introduce you, because it's such an important tradition that as a spiritual community that we welcome people in with a prayer into our community, and that we, that in that way, not just do that, but also means practically people know everybody's name. So actually the three people I'm going to introduce, they've been here actually, most of them, for about a year already. And so in a sense, even us doing this is a reminder to us that we should be more vigilant about doing this in a timely way. And so if you see somebody who's been here coming a while and you're a regular here, why not tell me and point out to me or Mr. Hayashi that we've overlooked something. And then you can help us to
really welcome. You would probably want to ask us, have you spoken to them? Do they want to be introduced? Because not necessarily everyone does, but at least we should give people that chance. So if you've seen someone coming 3 or 4 times regularly to service, come and let me know after that if nothing's happening. So I want to ask Jessica Stewart, Sean's wife, to come up, and also Chino, Chigo's brother, and also Kahi from Korea, Kahi Kang. Kahi's only going to be with us for another month, actually. So it's just in time, let's say. Chino's studying in London and living with his uncle or his older brother. And Jessica's come to move over here from America, and she's already working in London. And Kahi's been studying, yeah, in London and going back to Korea soon. So I just want to give them a chance to say a couple of words, although I've already introduced you. But Chino, do you want to start? Sorry, just give you a microphone.
I've been here for almost a year now. I live in like Lewisham, quite far from here. I'm from Malta, by the way, small island. Moved here in February last year. Obviously, everyone knows my brother Shiro. He's just gone. I miss him, but yeah. I like playing sports, obviously. That's all I can say about myself.
Hi, my name is, you can call me Jess. I've been here 7 months now. I'm living with the Greaves family in Stratford. And I grew up in New York, but I was actually born here. My father used to work in accounts here a long time ago, and so it's very nice to be back. I'm very happy to live in London again, and having a good time getting to know Simon and the community. So thank you for having me.
Hi everyone, my name is Kahi, and I've been 5 months almost. Even though I'm separated from my husband right now, but in Friday, finally, I can meet my man. And I'm studying English now, but I have a plan to go master course in London. So I will come back to London with my husband, maybe, yeah. And thank you for giving me this opportunity to introduce myself. And have a nice day. And I want to say, it's a little bit late, but in Korean, Happy New Year is 새해 복 많이 받으세요. Thank you so much.
Thanks. So if you guys just stay here while we want to say a prayer. So want to just ask if anyone in the audience would like to volunteer just to come up here to say a prayer for our brother here and our two sisters. So, anyone? Okay. All right, I can do it, yeah. Okay, please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we want to welcome Chino and Jessica and Kahi. And actually, they've already been here a long time. So what does that say about how we welcome people in our community? Heavenly Father, we want to be serious to create a spiritual community where you can be interceding in people's lives, you can be changing people's hearts, you can be reviving people, inspiring people, guiding people. Heavenly Father, we know that when we help each other with that, it makes it easier for you to work. And so I pray for my brothers and sisters here that their experience here can be valuable and precious, that they can find their place in the community, that they can find their calling here, that they can find their way to serve and and to make a difference for the other lives here. I pray for all of us that we can really care about their life. We can look out for them. We can look into their eyes and when we see them on a Sunday and just maybe have a sense of how their week went. And I pray that we don't just do that for them, but we all do that for one another. And I pray for your blessing on them now and report this in my name. Simon Cooper, Bless Central Family, Archie. Okay, thank you. So have a seat, guys. What did you all forget to do there that we normally do? I forgot to ask you to stand up. And why do we do that? Because we want, even though one person is praying, we want to stand up to also to be fully part of that prayer, to show those people here how much we are fully there for them. And through that, we get a sense of what is the spiritual atmosphere here. We get a sense for many things. And one of the other things I want us to think about, and I'd love to hear from you guys what you think about it, is what's the next step after we introduce people, we welcome people, people sign something. What's the next step for you as well? And how do we, you know, it used to be in the day, once you've been around for a while, you went off on MFT. Yeah. So I said to Jessica, is that the next step for her? And she obviously shook her head. But in 6 months' time, or what is the next step for once someone's made a commitment to be part of our community? And even those of us who have been maybe made a commitment a long time ago, what's the next step for us in this community? So that not simply for the sake of being systematic, but really for the sake of having intentional growth in our lives. And so this ceremony, brothers and sisters, it's not for show, it's not for ceremony, it's because we want to create something that's genuine and authentic, and so that's why we do it. Thanks for listening, and I won't carry on because otherwise I'll end up giving two sermons.
Going to sing a couple more songs. A few punchy numbers. The first is The Hand That Holds the World, and the second one is a new one, another song by Matt Redman that we're introducing into our community. So you can look forward to that. I think it's a beautiful song. But for now, let's start with one that you do know, The Hand That Holds the World. So please rise and let's sing all together. Daughter, say, son, free.
heaven sings. I want to hold the hand that holds the world. And I want to know the mystery. Reach out and touch the majesty. I want to hold the hand that holds the world. I want to stand before the King. Join in the song that heaven sings. I want to hold the hand that holds the world. I want to hold the hand. Reach out and hold the hand. I want to hold the hand that holds the world.
One time, all together.
So this is a new song, it's called Never Once, and the lyrics read, never once did we ever walk alone, never once did you leave us on our own. So it's a song with beautiful lyrics about the relationship God has had with us, even when we didn't have a relationship with him. He's never abandoned us, he's always been faithful in us, and I think inspires our faith in him. So. Yeah, let's sing it together.
Standing on this mountain top, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but for joy of us can say, yes, our hearts.
Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did we ever walk alone.
You know, today's Sunday service and message is, for me, it's significant because today is the day we have our AGM. That's a meeting we have once a year, a general meeting for our community. And the reason why that's important, I believe, is because it's so important to take stock in life, to see where we've got to see what we've accomplished, what we feel is still lacking, and to be able to capture that picture so that we know where we want to go in the year ahead, where we want to go not just as an individual, but as a body of people who are sharing in a faith together and part of a spiritual community together. And so I want to talk in moments about the AGM in the message today, but I want to carry on today with this theme about, you know, what will it take for us to care more deeply? What will it take for you and I to care in a more divine way about one another? And I just want to start with something that made me reflect about this last night. You know, quite often, if I'm the last person in the house to go to bed, I go up to the marital bedroom, and I don't see any space for me in the bed. And so I find myself shifting bodies, especially just the younger ones normally, but they're getting heavier. And nevertheless, I can still carry them. And so when I'm carrying these two younger boys to their room at night, sometimes actually I leave them and I think I'll just go and sleep in the top bunk in the other room. But actually then I think, no, God created you to sleep together with your wife. So move that body and sleep next to your wife. And that makes God happy. No? It might not make her happy if I wake her up in the process, but anyway. So as I'm carrying them, you know, it's interesting that there's a reaction in their sleep. There's sort of kind of movement. But they don't wake up. They don't wake up. And as I'm carrying them, I don't like horror films, but I have horror movie thoughts sometimes. And I think, what if it wasn't me carrying this little boy, but someone who broke into our house to kidnap him away? Would he wake up? Or would he carry on like he is now, trusting and just lying in that person's arms? And that sends a chill down my spine. But one thing, of course, that I'm really trying to come to terms with and understand is that somehow he still, even though in the middle of sleep, when someone picks him up, especially the one I got to put in the top bunk, and that's quite an art, he still carries on sleeping in trust and in a sense of being secure and safe. And I can do it because I'm big enough to carry them, and they're small enough to still trust and still have faith in those arms that are carrying them. You know, if someone was to pick up you, or you, or me, it would be a different matter, wouldn't it? It would be so difficult that you would wake up in the process. But probably you would wake up almost the second someone touches you, because maybe you don't sleep like little children sleep anymore. And so, yes, we're heavier to carry, but it would be a hard job for someone to pick us up and carry us in our sleep to somewhere else. And it's, again, we would wake up because we don't have that same trust quite as much as we once did. You know, I told you this little story, this little anecdote, not because I want to tell you about what I do when I go to bed, because sometimes that's very private. But because I want us to understand more about how can we care in a deeper way about one another. And how when we allow God's love and care to be at the center of our heart and our life, then we're able to care more deeply. And you know, we then realize that God's love is big enough. God has arms strong enough to carry all of us together. That when you and I just try to care about others on our own and without God, we're going to struggle to really do it. We're going to struggle to really transform that other person who needs our care or whatever they need. So I'm really tempted to make a joke at your expense now, George, but but I'm not going to. I'm going to be more disciplined with myself. You know, in order for God to carry us, it requires us that we love him and trust him like those two little boys, at least in their sleep, love and trust me when I carry them. But a big question for us is, do we love and trust God like children love and trust their parents? You know, Jesus said when his disciples were squabbling over which one of them was the most important, he said, firstly, he didn't say anything. He called a little child over to be amongst them, to just make a point. And then he said, truly I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. And it's sad, isn't it, when you hear people talk about don't be like a little child, as if it's a derogatory thing. But Jesus was talking about it as a way of complimenting people. Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position, he says, of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Unless we can be humble and trusting like children. So, you know, I wish on the eve of our AGM, as your pastor, I could come up here and articulate to you a perfect vision that's authentic and completely convinces you of where we're going this year and in the years ahead. And that I could tell you that at the end of this year, we will all have markedly grown spiritually and have naturally, as a result, grown in number. And that I have a solution to all the problems in our community. But, you know, I don't. And, you know, sometimes as a pastor, I feel like I'm fighting an uphill battle. Being a pastor. Maybe some of you feel like in your work you're fighting an uphill battle doing whatever you do. And it's probably largely more because of me than because of you that I'm finding it's an uphill battle. So it's not necessarily a comment on the congregation. But, you know, we have this AGM and I sent out an email with a kind of review and a reflection and report about the last 12 months that we spent together. And, you know, about 100 of you opened the email and about less than a third of that 100 actually opened the report in the email. So about 30 of you bothered to read that. And I'm naive, I accept I'm naive. I've always been naive. And in a way, I want to hold on to my naivety in life because I think that's what keeps me, in a funny sort of way, close to God. Let's maybe call it innocence rather than naivety. But somehow, even though I have to tell myself, Simon, you know, how much do people like to read the reports and so forth? Nevertheless, it's still a sign for me of how relevant the work I do is for the community. Because if you're not interested in what I think about what we've done this year, then it, of course, naturally, if I've got any rational sense, it makes me question whether it's what I do is really valuable. And that's a healthy thing, and I'm glad I sent the report out. Otherwise, I wouldn't maybe be reflecting in that way. But it also makes me realize I need your help. I need you, some of you, to step up more. I need some of you to help organize more. To need some of you to volunteer because you want to volunteer more. I need some of you to take more initiative. To spend more of your time thinking creatively about your community. To put more time into praying, as I know some of you do pray a lot, but maybe God wants to hear the prayers of some other of you in this room about your community, and that you were to act on those prayers. You know, our cafe is a great example of something we did that we changed here. And I know everyone really appreciates our cafe, and people always comment on it, especially if they haven't been here for a couple of years, and the last time they're here, they saw it was an office, and they're really inspired by it. But you know, that cafe, probably if you and I were to think about it, could be 10 times better, couldn't it? And we could rip down that cafe sign for a start, because what does that say? Not much, and it's been there for 3 years now, and it's looking a bit tired. But don't you think that the cafe could be 10 times better than it is? And I'm not really talking about the cafe because, you know, our purpose and raison d'etre is to have a cafe. But I'm trying to hint and get to a point about, you know, how I need your help. And so I said all of that, and I guess this is my chance to say something before the AGM. And I really want to encourage everyone to come to the AGM. And that's your turn. That's your chance then to also tell me what needs to be said from your side. But certainly we need, as a community, to ask, if we want to get the right answers to our personal life or to our community life, we need to be asking and finding and thinking about what are the right questions we need to ask. What are the questions that we need to ask to find our way as a community? And that's really to do with how can we illuminate our reality? Sometimes it takes something pretty rough and rocky in our life to truly illuminate our personal or family or community or movement reality. You know, when you've been working somewhere for a long time, it's often hard to see things with fresh eyes. So when I started and got involved in this community, I could truly say I think I saw things with fresh eyes. And together with some of you, we all saw things with fresh eyes. But I've been working here for a while now, and I'm not sure if my eyes are as fresh as they were and if they're as fresh as often as they need to be when I look at things. You know how it is in the house when something cracks or breaks or gets damaged, and it bugs you in the beginning that door doesn't shut properly. It bugs you that that there's a crack in that mirror or that the bathroom doesn't lock properly and people keep walking in on you when you're sitting down. Whatever it is, it bugs you. But funnily enough, do you know what happens? Because we're so adaptable as human beings, even though we maybe have said a couple of times, I'm going to fix that, we get used to it. Like in our house, it's always the mouse on the desktop that doesn't seem to work properly, and it's only after the 1,000th time of the children complaining do I get it fixed and I buy a new one, and it's wireless, and it seems to annoy them all the more. But we no longer see the critical issues when our eyes are tired, when we've got used to something. And I'm thankful and I'm grateful to those of you who are always praying and trying to see the critical issues and telling me what you see, however harsh you may sometimes say it and however painful it is sometimes. I'm grateful for that. But again, that's the purpose of this AGM, is that how could we do things differently? What should we be doing differently? What should we be stopping doing? What should we be starting doing? You know, again, when I first met this movement, I had what Wesley, which were the Wesley brothers, was it? Let me remind myself. John Wesley. John Wesley described having a strange, warm feeling once when he went to a meeting. You know, when I met the unification movement, I experienced a strange, warm feeling. And it changed my life. And many of you had that experience, whether because you joined this movement or because you went to a workshop when you were growing up. And that's probably partly why you're here today. But actually, to keep that strange, warm feeling alive is not always easy. And for us to care more deeply is not always easy. You know, to care in a way that brings new life to someone, that transforms their life, to care so that you bring hope to someone who's going through incredible difficulty, to bring healing to someone who's really hurt and injured and wounded, to bring confidence to someone who's really doubting about everything in their life. To care in that kind of way, I don't think we can do it on our own. But I think, isn't that the kind of care that we're looking for, that we want to strive for, that we want to be able to emanate and we want to be able to receive? So actually, if we believed that we really wanted to care more, it will, and that was a focus for us as a community this year, it will raise certain questions in your head and in your heart that are going to be awkward and difficult questions. Because one thing is that if we want to care more deeply, we have to really believe in our heart and also practice what we believe in our heart, but we have to really believe that people matter to God. And that I don't care about people just because I'm a person, but because I know God cares and people matter to God. We also have to believe that God, that people need God's intervention in their life. Because I know at some point you've believed that God needs to intervene in people's lives, but when you're faced with it, how comfortable is it to be a channel for God so that he can intervene in someone's life? How willing are you to be that channel that God is going to be able to use you to intervene in someone's life and change it? Yeah. Personally, I'd rather have a nice, friendly conversation. But sometimes God wants you to have more than that. You know, if we start to ask the right questions, we'll start to find the right path for our community. Because we'll get the right answers. You know, a great question here. Because this is really important. Because maybe you just come here for the first time, but many of you here, most of you, you come here regularly, and you're planning to come to, as a Unificationist, Foundation Day registration on the 22nd of February, and there's a holy wine ceremony that we will have before that, which we'll actually have on God's Day, which is, the good news is on a Sunday, 10th of February. But you know, to take part in all of that, there's a big question that you've got to ask yourself is, do true parents have the power in your eyes, in your heart, to forgive and to give God's grace? Because, you know, whether you confidently believe in that or not is going to be quite critical to what you experience on Foundation Day. If you're really kind of a bit in a sort of ambiguous state of mind about that, it will just be a ceremony. If you fundamentally don't believe that, you probably shouldn't take part, you know, if you've got any ethics. If you believe it's true, then you will have a very special experience. So, you know, these questions, I'm sure many of us have been through them in our past. I went through them when I joined this movement, and, you know, also, okay, true. I believe that true parents can bring forgiveness. Do I? And then the next question, of course, is, do I need forgiveness? So that's probably the next question you need to ask yourself. Do you need forgiveness in your life for who you are? Do you need grace in your life because of where you are? Because again, your answer to that question will really be pivotal in terms of what you really decide to do. And I think though many of us have had very strong and clear answers of yes to those questions, along the way, when certain things have come up in our life, in our marriage or in relationships with other brothers and sisters, at work, in our mission, etc., we've gone yes, no, or maybe, and we decided to get a bit vaguer on those questions, because if we were to say yes, it would be putting us in a situation where we have to not just believe something that's maybe challenging, but do something that's challenging. So, you know, maybe I've got to a place, or you've got to a place where you said, maybe I can live a good life without the church community, or maybe two parents have not got everything right, or maybe it doesn't make so much difference if I don't tithe, or I do tithe, or if I study God's word, or I don't study God's word, or if I pray, or if I don't pray. You know, these things have started to become grey for you. Now, that's why Foundation Day is there, for those things no longer be grey for you anymore. You know, for us to care deeply, we have to be able to talk about these things for a start, don't we? With one another, no? Like, talk about your relationship with God and how you feel about your parents. You have to be able to talk to people about it. If you can't talk about it, it's probably there's something that's not quite right there, or something unclear there, or something, some question marks. You know, if I want to go to someone who's going through the biggest difficulty in their life, they're facing a great fear. Bye, Sue. I want to tell them, you know, don't give up, because when you're afraid, you often give up in life. That's what happens, right? And I want to say to them, don't give up, even though what you're facing is frightening, is challenging, is making you feel really uncomfortable. Don't give up. Have faith that God in God, and allow God to work in your situation. Now, how can I say that? How can any of us say that to someone? If when we're faced with our fears, we give up, or we put our faith in a place other than God. So actually, this kind of nice idea that I've got, that we could all care more deeply about each other this year, you know, interestingly enough, it comes down first to really being clear about what we believe, being responsible towards what we believe. And I wouldn't want to ask anyone in this community to care more deeply if they decided that they didn't believe some of those things I was talking about. I wouldn't want to put that on them. I would still want them to feel welcome here. I would still want them to feel that this community is there for them. But the people I really want to call on here today is those of you who have decided that those are the things you really believe in, and to step up to it. Step up to the responsibility towards those things. You know, John Wesley, I just want to read to you about that warm, strange experience he had, because he had been on a mission to America and it hadn't gone very well. He was an Anglican minister and he'd gone on this mission and it hadn't gone well, and he had a lot of doubts about what he believed in and his faith. And so he came back to London with a questioning faith and a troubled faith. And this is in 1738, quite a few hundred years ago. And he's 34 years old. And he describes going to a meeting in London, a worship service in London. And it's called the Aldersgate Experience. And if you go to the City of London, you can see a big brass plaque with his words on it. And across the road, you can see the little place, the meeting place, where he had this experience, an experience that many of you have also had. And in that difficult, unclear, questioning his life, his faith moment, this is what he wrote. In the evening I went very unwillingly to a society in Aldersgate Street, where someone was reading Luther's preface to the Epistle of the Romans. About a quarter before nine, while the leader was describing the change which God works in the heart through faith in Christ, I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ alone for salvation. And an assurance was given me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. And so what out of that moment grew the Methodist movement, the Methodist Church. And so when people want to have a big debate about something today, or they want to talk about how God is going to do something in our country, where do they meet to pray? Where do they go to discuss and debate? Right opposite Parliament at Central Methodist Hall, that enormous building. And so from that one warm, strange experience in someone's house, in someone's service, a movement grew. So for us to care about people here, we need to actually believe in the teaching and have faith in true parents, not in a maybe way, but in a definite way. We have a responsibility towards what we believe in. So what is going to happen at Foundation Day is we will see, if we're clear about this, we will see that, again, that true parents have the power to forgive. That makes them special and different. I'm not personally high church. I'm not into true parents being made divine as God, but what makes them God's chosen people and what makes true father the Messiah and true parents the second advent is that they have a bank account spiritually. That means that in front of God and in front of Satan, they can forgive people. They have the spiritual wealth with which to do that. So don't miss out on that. You know, okay, I want to just say a couple more things. And I just want to read you, actually, before I forget something, because I can be forgetful, from True Father. Okay. And this is, I think, maybe helps us understand how we will get to a process of caring more deeply. It is a teaching of the principle that God dwells in an individual whose mind and body are in oneness. Why does God dwell there? Love most certainly dwells where a person's mind and body, what they believe in, clearly, what they've decided to believe in and what they do, are united. Love is the starting point of unity. The object partner's love brings God near to dwell there. It is said that human beings are temples of God. What kind of place is a holy temple? Is it a place of work? No. A temple is a place of rest and tranquility. Where can we rest? We can rest in the midst of God's love. That is the most ideal place, don't you agree? So we can be God's temple, and we can be God's temples when we can rest in God's love. We aspire to have such a mind with God's love and peace abiding within our innermost heart. Then we would dwell in what is called the world of heart, Shimjung. That place is like an ever-flowing spring of the purest fresh water. Love and peace well up from within, never ceasing, never stagnating. It is endless because who dwells there? Because God dwells there. Become that kind of person, a temple of God, and you can comfort those who are crying out in pain. So the comfort, the care that we bring comes from that kind of experience, that kind of reality in our life. So one thing I spoke about last week that I just want to mention briefly now is that at the end of this month, we're not going to have a service here. There will be the harp service and carp service, but we won't have our morning service. We want to hold a service in people's homes. And I started asking around a bit because, you know, there's 50% of us in our community. There's about 250 people in our community. Actually, I'll just tell you, there's 127 people connected and involved in our community who are over 23 years old, 127. There's 31 aged between 19 to 23. There's about 27 aged 12 to 18. And there's 29 aged 0 to 12. And 50% of all of that, all of us, come along twice or more a month. The other 50% obviously come less than twice a month, means either once a month or less than once a month, which is, mathematicians, zero, yeah? So, but they connect in other ways and do lots of great things. But if those figures are true, then shouldn't we be then doing something different? And so what we want to experiment, at least just this once, end of the month, is to hold a service in as many people's homes as possible and for as many of us to come along and experience being cared for and being intimate with each other in each other's homes. You know, one person told me the reason why actually they don't come so often is where they live, it costs them £8 to come here and go home on a Sunday, and actually that's a challenge for them. So there's many different reasons why people may or may not come. But unless we find other places to meet, maybe we won't discover them. So, just as in the conclusion, I shared this analogy about a father carrying his children to their bed and how they, if they really love and trust him, they don't wake up, but that they just willingly melt into those arms. And I use that analogy for you to understand how you need to have that kind of childlike trust and love in God. And I just want to just finish with one last little illustration and analogy that came to my mind when I was making a fire the other day. Because we have a wood burner in our house now, and so I'm the only person who really seems to want to generally take care of these fires. And I just noticed actually how sometimes the fire would light and sometimes it wouldn't light. In the beginning, even though I put a lot of air in there, still it doesn't light. But when it's really, really hot, it doesn't need so much air. But certainly from all of that, I realized that for the wood to burn, and maybe the geologists in the house will tell me later if I got this right or not, or the scientists from across the park. But for something to burn, it needs heat and oxygen. And I noticed when the fire's really hot and I put a new fresh bit of fuel on the fire, it will burn up really quickly if I completely open the air vent. And the flames will just start covering it and consuming that log. And it will be on fire. But if I don't let any of that oxygen in, that air, it will just smolder away. So what is it that we need to really set us on fire this year? Is it maybe learning to care based on what we believe in for one another? Being willing to be God's channel to intervene in someone else's life, whether here or outside here, in your workplace, in your college? Are you willing to find whatever it is that oxygen is in your life so that you can burn for God this year. And with that, just join me in a prayer. Heavenly Father, as we gathered here this morning, we're still on the edge of this new year, 2013. And tomorrow is actually exactly 40 days till Foundation Day. Heavenly Father, a group of people can go somewhere when they have something that they can unite about. Heavenly Father, please, as a group of people here, we ask you to speak to each person's heart, that we can be clear about what we believe in, and we can, amongst ourselves, be clear about what we want to unite about. We know, though, that we want to care more deeply about one another, that it's not something we can do just on our own. Heavenly Father, we need you to be living inside us. We need you to be guiding our hearts. And so, in every which way you can, Heavenly Father, I pray that you can guide the hearts of this congregation this week. That you can give them many moments to reflect on and moments to pause, moments to ask significant questions about how what they're about to do is going to be in line with what they believe. Heavenly Father, let us make our mind and our body one so that your peace and tranquility can live inside our heart. Heavenly Father, on that basis, let us care for one another and build your kingdom, Chonilguk, on this earth. I pray and report this in my name, Simon Cooper, of a blessed central family, Arju. Okay, brothers and sisters, so shall we invite the band back? And let's sing a song together and take some time to pray and reflect about this week ahead, what we want to do, where we want to be. God bless you.
Father, for this day, thanks for the opportunity of being together, and guide us, Lord, in this meeting we have today, the AGM, so we can think, we can gather our ideas, our creative characteristic that we have got from you, Lord, to help community and to help others, to make a difference in people's life, Lord. And we can give you that glory, Lord. Please receive all these offers, my brothers and sisters, I give them to you today, Lord. And make it work, Lord, for the community, for your ideal, Lord. Thank you very much, Lord, for this day. I report this prayer in the name of true parents and in my name, in the name of all my brothers and sisters. Generally was teachers in the name of and of a blessed center couple, would you?
Okay, please be seated. So we're coming to the end of our service today. So just a couple of things. There will be the reports from the community leaders. That will be outside. Raymond will put those outside. So if you want to collect those during lunch, so you can have a read of them before the AGM at 2 o'clock. Also, today we have a beautiful Japanese chicken curry served with rice, which has been lovingly prepared for us by Reiko Hayashi and Yoshi and Masa. So please don't rush off. Please stay and enjoy with us and have a great and blessed week. Thank you.
Don't you say it's too early, baby, I don't want to waste the day, when we've everything on our side and nothing in our way. We can do what we wanna, 'cause today the world is ours. Nothing gray, just real time and color.